Want a photograph, huh? Papa photograph.
Thank you.
Where are they?
You want to speak to Gav?
No.
I think you say a few words before it. Nothing?
Don't worry, nothing. Every day I'm in touch with them.
Thank you and good afternoon. Thank you all for coming here. Thank you, KPCC President Dishu Kumar Ji, our former President Dinesh Kundu Rao Ji, my colleagues in the PCC. Friends, today, as you're aware, the AICC has given out a very strong statement against what the Government of India has outlined a week ago. The Government of India has come out with a policy, the National Modernization Policy, the NMP. I want to spend a few minutes just enunciating what the policy entails and what it is that I think is of great danger for our economy and for the future of this country. Privatization versus disinvestment versus monetization. I think this play of words needs to be explained very clearly. They say the NMP will get a revenue of 6 lakh crores over the next 4 years. 1.5 lakh crores is what the finance minister said they will get by quote unquote monetizing these assets. The question is, what are these assets? We have roads, highways, megawatt power projects, transmission lines, gas pipelines, food grain storage, telecom fiber, telecom towers, airports, ports, national stadiums, mining blocks, and railways. These are all assets, and some of them are core strategic assets. These assets have been built over the last 6 decades with the hard-earned money of our taxpayers. These assets are making money. The Government of India says that they will monetize it to put money into infrastructure. The Prime Minister has on 3 occasions from the Red Fort in Delhi announced 100 lakh crore investment for infrastructure. 3 years consecutively the same announcement has been made, 100 lakh crores for infrastructure. This money that the Government of India will raise, will it go to fulfill the 5.5 lakh crore deficit that we are running today? Is it there to boost revenues? Is it there to put fresh infrastructure in place? But the monetization and the quote-unquote strategic giving away of our assets is something that the Congress Party and the people of India are in opposition. 91, when Manmohan Singh Ji was the finance minister, in 91 when Narasimha Rao Ji was prime minister, it was the Congress Party which started the liberalized economy regime. We have always been pro-investment, pro-growth, and I think to my mind, India is where it is today because of that turn the economy took in 1991. But today, the same BJP, which has the Swadeshi Jagran Manch, the Bharatiya Kisan Sangh, opposing these policies where the Government of India says Atmanirbhar Bharat, today these assets are being put on the block. The question is, where is the process? Where is the transparency? And these railways, ports and airports that are now being given out, finance minister says that the ownership will be with the Government of India. Now, in 30 to 50 years, when all these assets have been drained from all their value, what will the Government of India get back if the lease is not extended? We are of the opinion that these strategic assets and these public sector undertakings, these infrastructures, if they are given to few individuals, it will create in our economy either monopolies or duopolies. And I've been a minister for corporate affairs, and I know there is a Competition Commission of India where the government of the day objective and focus is there should be fair competition, healthy competition. But when you only have a handful of players in very important sectors such as aviation, railways, coal mining, power transmission, you create monopolies and duopolies. Then the taxpayer will be charged more money, and we will end up in a system where, and here's the irony of it, the public sector undertakings were constructed when land was acquired almost free or very cheap. So the taxpayer, the Indian citizen, gave its tax money, land and assets for the government to develop public sector. That public sector for the last 50, 60 years has been working. So today, the people who will actually finance this purchase, the quote-unquote leasing of 50 years, they will take money from public sector banks, private entities, buy public sector, lay off people, reduce the jobs, make profits, and give 1.5 lakh crores. Now the government of India fails to tell us they are making 1.5 lakh crores, but what it is that these assets are giving us today? We're only making the difference, you see. Congress Party's manifesto last time, general election, he had said that loss-making entities, which are non-strategic in nature, please I underscore this, they were non-strategic in nature, loss-making entities, which did not have a large market share of any sector, they would be allowed to have investments. Or we could think of making more money by selling off some shares of those assets. But this government, I think the handling of the economy, we have the highest unemployment rates in India ever. We have seen poverty rise. We have seen the rich getting very rich. We have seen gross mismanagement during the COVID crisis. We have seen every sector of our economy fall apart. The government of India gave 20 lakh crore stimulus package. I wish to ask the government of India, who has benefited from that package? Every large country in the world gave what the Congress Party has been saying, Mr. Gandhi has been saying, that you give money to the poorest, give money to the middle classes so that they are able to consume and purchase more. But the government of India tried to give a stimulus package, which is all imaginary, and 20 lakh crores, I remember those press conferences where they went at length to explain how much money they were giving, the stimulus package, but the result was that the economy is shrinking, the small and medium enterprise is shrinking, job losses are at highest, poverty is increased, and all sectors, the government has failed to perform. I do take the point that government should not be in the business of running hotels, perhaps, or even airlines, the tourism sector, for example. But the railways, mining, telecom sector, any right-thinking country will understand that those are strategic assets. And what stops the PE funds or international funds to make an SPV and invest through an Indian entity and pick up stake in these very important strategic assets? So this question is not just about gross mismanagement of the economy. The question is, what is India's priority? I think it is not just the Congress Party, but every right-thinking Indian will ask the question that if you are able to not generate revenues, should you be selling a family silver at this rate? And here was a government which had opposed everything when UPA was in power. They opposed the US nuclear deal, they opposed liberalized economy, they opposed WTO, they opposed Aadhaar card when we started the Aadhaar card, they opposed the direct benefit transfers when we started that, they opposed the GST, and now there's a complete turnaround in what they say and what they do. Today, the biggest challenge we face is that the government has actually stopped caring about the price rise that we face. Today, petrol and diesel is costing more than 100 rupees a litre. I mean, I was in Rajasthan in some place and they said, sir, that petrol diesel now costs more than desi ghee. You know what pure ghee costs? I remember the statements of our friends in BJP when the petrol diesel was 60 rupees a litre, 65 rupees a litre. The cooking gas cylinder is now 900 rupees a cylinder. Instead of curbing inflation, instead of setting the economy right, they have actually, I think, squandered away a lot of the money in vanity projects. The priority is absolutely defocused. Inflation is as highest. And look at the slogans we've heard in the last 7 years. We've heard smart cities. We've heard Swachh Bharat, Stand Up India, Startup India, Make in India, the Ganga, is it any cleaner than it was? So in 7 years, we've had 17 slogans. And delivery has been zero. But this particular issue that's been taken up, there was no stakeholders that were invited or called for consultations when the modernization policy was announced. There was no talks with trade unions. And I fear at a time where jobs are so scarce, that selling off of these assets, the private entities, when they take over, they will certainly lay off huge number of people to be more profitable. That means more jobs will be lost. No discussion with trade unions, no discussion with stakeholders, no discussion. Parliament has become a mockery because the government of India does not believe in having a healthy debate in parliament. So therefore, all these things, there was no consultation paper, there was no views invited, there was no discussion of any sort. It was just a unilateral decision, which this government is known for, decided, announced the NMP, and say the process is also not very well illustrated. So our fear is that not only the process is questionable, but the end beneficiaries, will it be the same people who we suspect will get a hands on India's ports, railways and airports, and coal mining and power transmission and a cable network and an underground fiber network? These are important assets. They have taken a lot of effort to make those assets. It's not a party's property. A government is only a trustee of the people of India. It has to act with transparency. It has to show credibility. It has to show that its heart and policies are in the right place. Sad to say, it's the complete opposite today in New Delhi. The government of India, the way it's functioned, leaves a lot to be desired for. I think what is also important is that the government of India is known for marketing and branding. I recall we had a very successful polio eradication program. For decades it went on. I never saw the then prime ministers or the then leaders of the government marketing themselves or making the people feel obliged that we're giving a free polio. You know, remember those Do Bund polio? Everybody got that for free. It was a mass national campaign and we had a huge success. Similarly, the HIV campaign, the NACO campaign. But this vaccination itself was very controversial because it was being sold to governments, different price for government of India, different price for state governments, and then different price for hospitals. Clearly, there'll be black marketing and hoarding when you have the same product and three different prices. After a lot of pressure, they said, okay, fine, we'll get it for free. And now the branding and marketing has taken over the entire exercise of the government of India. So I think a lot needs to be discussed before we go ahead with this. We are here not just to oppose what the government is doing in terms of the asset selling off, but also the fact that it begs the question about our integrity, our security issues, and the fact that no one was taken on board. To get this 1.5 lakh crores that they're doing by giving this asset for 50, 30 years, and then they say ownership will be the government of India. What is the ownership? It's a piece of paper. 5 decades later, if the lease is renewed, the person, the entity gets to keep the asset. And if you get it back, what is the depreciated value? I must know when I'm giving something to somebody for 50 years, in what condition will I get it back? What will be the market price of that asset when I get it back in 50 years? So this sort of collusion is something that the people want answers for. And I'm here today in Mangaluru to share with you what the party's stand is on these particular issues. I think it's important to ask the right questions. It's important for the government to take cognizance of what the opposition says. It's important to answer us, not just outside, but inside of parliament. Sadly, last parliament session was a washout because of the various questions that were asked of the government and they had no replies. So the best is to keep adjourning the house and not having to answer the question that the MPs are raising. So the Congress party is very clear on what it stands for vis-a-vis this issue and all other issues, whether it's issues of on snooping on people. When I say the decision is unilateral, you will understand when the government of India can impose on this nation's farmers those three farm bills that the whole country is opposing. I mean, this NMP policy also was done without any consultation. And I'm sad to say, as a farmer for last almost a year, our farmers are on the streets. What happened in Haryana 2 days ago, the brutality of the Haryana police, it's shameful. And I'm absolutely surprised that the Chief Minister of Haryana is defending the officials who are giving orders on record to break the farmers' heads. This sort of brute force, this violence, is not reflective of our democracy, of our ethos. We may be different parties, but this country belongs to everybody. So this systematic dismantling of our principles, of our ideology, what this country stands for, of shedding apart our constitutional values, of using brute force to suppress voice, to spy on people, to muffle the voice of the opposition, I think the Congress party has taken a very firm stand, no matter what the cost to us, but we'll continue to raise our voices, to talk about the people and the farmers. And this particular issue of national modernization policy is something that the country is opposing, and the Congress party is standing against this move, and we will go to any extent to make sure that the government does not go ahead with this really lopsided mandate that they have for themselves. And finally, I believe that politics is about governance, when you get elected to positions of power, you have to use that position to benefit the people. I don't know if this selling of these assets will double the farmers' income. I don't know if this money will actually go to all the people. 15 lakh rupees that was announced and proposed for every citizen in India to get that money. It will just be to make a new building complex or to do some vanity projects. Therefore, the intention, the policy, the agenda, the process of the policy itself is in question. So we are here to oppose it. I want to thank Honorable President of KPCC, Jip Kumarji, and of course, former President, for having me here and for the warm welcome that I received.